us a quick word about how this paper is kind of situated in my greater work. It's part of a larger project. I've recently really been interested in the notion of what it means to have a differential ontology. And definitely, I keep coming back to difference and repetition, since that plays a very prominent role there. But this paper itself is kind of in the middle of this so-called project that I'm invested in right now. So it has a very kind of odd place, and I'm not really sure what the point of it is. I don't know if it's really a critique of Deleuze or an explication. It's definitely not an application. So it is what it is, and I hope it's somewhat entertaining. Okay. Just another note too. Most of this deals exclusively with difference and repetition. So any quotes I kind of throw out, it's from there. Okay. It's entitled "The Event of Proliferation: Malfunction and Auto Cancellation in Deleuze's Differential Ontology." A philosophy of difference, or a differential ontology, contains the burden of problematizing its own transcendental operations and processes. So if we were to take Deleuze's notion of the event seriously, we must recognize the dynamism and fragility of the virtual. This paper is not interested in how the virtual consistently produces or expressed in the regular and ordered empirical world of which we are accustomed. My focus, rather, is whether or not these ontological processes are susceptible to changes in their own operation and their nature that compromise ontology as such, yet without drastically altering many of the regularities within which we are embedded. Can a virtual malfunction, an ontological transformation, occur imperceptibly without the world of the actual dissolving before our eyes? Can the deepest ontological mechanisms undergo change rather than just the content of the physical realities that they produce? The important consequence surrounding these questions is that while Deleuze will say that in the event nothing happens but everything becomes, there is perhaps an immobile event that could render this very becoming impotent. I will thus suggest proliferation as such an event. The prolific event is thus the harnessing of differential forces that alters its very own ontological structure and operation. While Deleuze declares that the virtual is structure, it is the very adaptability of such a structure that defines the virtual as a dynamic and evolving system. Therefore, the significance of the mantra, being is becoming, resounds in the perpetual production of new virtual structures that will be forever determined or incarnated in actualities. Yet this power of difference, vis-a-vis transformation, seems to pertain only to the product of the established ontological operation defined by difference and becoming. In other words, what changes are the elements in their organization or determination, and not fundamental principles or logic that govern ontology. The problem that philosophy such as Deleuze's face, therefore, is how to account for changeless change, because if being is difference or becoming, how can it be that these dynamic principles, as the most fundamental categories of being, remain stable and consistent in spite of their own logic, of which they appear to contradict? The question whether it is truly possible to have an ontology based on a stable set of dynamic principles remains largely untouched by Deleuze. His presupposition seems to be that if difference is productive, it will necessarily produce new differences compatible with the repetition of this core ontology. Now, Deleuze recognizes this paradox, but only by way of his assertion that a changeless change is consistent with his ontology. For example, he says that the third synthesis of time, indifference repetition, employs a static order, or a crushing unity, as well as that time is the most radical form of change, but itself does not change. Nevertheless, Deleuze does not offer a justification or proof of this ontological commitment. Nevertheless, the question that I wish to examine is what an ontological transformation would amount to given the ontology that Deleuze advances. In other words, not where is his proof, not is this possible, but what would it look like? As hard as it may be to accept, Deleuze, strictly speaking, is not a philosopher of difference. Well, perhaps I should clarify that. maybe it's more fitting to say that Deleuze is a philosopher of difference, yet he advances a philosophy of the differential. The distinction is that Deleuze does not embrace a merely haphazard and indiscriminate affirmation of pure difference as such. So against the recent statement expressed by one scholar that Deleuze's notion of difference remains difference all the way down, I would suggest that nearly all of Deleuze's account of the productive nature of difference, as well as the perpetuation, repetition, and becoming associated with that difference, is necessarily tempered by and dependent on a complex, rigorous, and no doubt subtle account of order. A differential philosophy is then the treatment of ordered difference. It is paramount to recognize that the differential is neither difference nor becoming. Just focusing on difference repetition, this is a very complicated distinction. Deleuze seems to equivocate the notions of difference, the differential, and becoming, even though he rarely uses this last term explicitly. Nevertheless, I think this can be parsed in such a way that difference, the differential, and becoming form a tripartite union, both discrete and endlessly intertwined. Deleuze often speaks of the unity or convergence of difference by using phrases such as reunite, gather up, and draw together to describe the relation between differences. He also describes the dark precursor as that which allows the communication between differences. It is at these times that I suggest Deleuze is referring to the ordering power of the differential. Of course, at other times, Deleuze emphasizes the productive and creative power of difference by focusing on the processes of becoming without any mention of order. And moreover, in his explicit discussions of the differential, it becomes complicated because he frequently defines the differential in the very terms of difference of becoming. So how are these three notions really distinct? The formulation that I would offer is that the differential is a mechanism, that is, a process that regulates and calibrates the differences that it joins to the becomings that it channels. Thus, even though difference is productive, and is positively defined by its own internal character, rather than negation or contradiction, it is clearly distinct from the process that accomplishes it and carries it out. In other words, becoming, as we normally conceive of it, is split in two in this text, the way he deals with it. Difference is productive and is defined by this glimmer of becoming on the one hand, but it is only through repetition that difference is actually produced. Since, as Deleuze says, repetition changes nothing, and that in the event nothing happens. Repetition is only a full becoming when it is a repetition of difference. Likewise, difference is only a full becoming when it is repeated. Therefore, to understand becoming as a change or transformation requires that this producing process be distinguished from the productive element of difference. All of this is to say that difference is ontologically distinct from becoming, even though they are thoroughly interdependent. So, difference and becoming are bound together because they are fused by some third thing, the differential. As a point of comparison, we can say analogously that this relationship is like Kant's schematism. The differential asserts a heterogeneity between difference and its becoming by being somewhat homogeneous, as it were, with each. For Kant, it was time that performed the mediation or combination of concept and object. However, to regard the differential in a similar fashion is to understand it not as a mediation, but as a relation and process of ordering. Again, the differential is the regulation and calibration of the becoming of difference. Deleuze makes this somewhat clear when he states in several passages that the differential is the play of difference, as well as identifying the differential element with difference itself. It is these elements that are taken up by the differential relation, thereby undergoing several processes of determination. Moreover, Deleuze says that the multiplicity is the organization of the many as such, wherein this many must be understood as, quote, only the variety of multiplicity, in other words, difference. Along these lines, he gives three conditions for the emergence of a multiplicity that coincide with the three aspects of the differential. Without going into the details, this example illustrates the nature of the differential as that which regulates and orders both emergence, in this case, as the process of becoming, and multiplicity as difference itself. Now we can return to the problematic announced previously. Understanding Deleuze's ontology as differential opens up a particular kind of ontological transformation. an event that is a malfunction of the differential organization at the heart of his ontology. What Deleuze says of the event elsewhere, namely, like as I mentioned before, nothing happens in the event, but everything becomes, is consistent with the passages in Difference and Repetition where he describes the third synthesis of time. It is the unfolding of the empty form of time, according to Deleuze, that employs a static order, a crushing unity. The event is thus already situated as a more stringent form of order that intensifies the ordering power of the differential. Now, since the differential produces a dynamic system of order according to shifting organizations of difference and becoming, a malfunction is possible that alters the regulation and calibration of this order. If the event undergoes a small change in its differential organization, it can become proliferation. Now we enter the purely hypothetical realm of my paper. It's a virtual component of contagion. Proliferation is its secret autonomous reproduction. A contagion is not transmitted through proliferation. Rather, proliferation is the power of contagion. In this regard, it is not the virus that is dangerous, but the power through which it can spread and multiply, the space that it covers, consumes, and fills. The danger of proliferation is not a spreading of difference. On the contrary, the danger is an inherent immobilization of the ontological forces it once propelled. Proliferation is the self-destruction of difference. Becoming has turned against itself. The differential relations of becoming and difference reach an attunement wherein their symbiotic organization is compromised. Difference loses its power of becoming, and becoming can no longer produce difference. Thus, proliferation is their ultimate cancellation, wherein it is a hyperorder that polarizes difference and becoming by initiating an organization that no longer fuses them together, but rather that sabotages their operation via their own respective intensification. Proliferation is movement, an exponential movement that renders all that it cuts through engulfs and envelops and captures immobile, the movement of immobility. Proliferation as a multiplication and expansion of words, texts, identities, contagions, weapons, commodities, or capital is nothing other than its own repetition and reproduction. That is, despite the numerous empirical examples that can serve as conceptual models for proliferation, only in the simplest of terms is proliferation a proliferation of something. Proliferation in itself has nothing to do with whatever particular incarnations through which it is enacted. A good illustration of this is found in mathematics, where we can see a proliferation in recursive functions. In the simplest of terms, a recursive function is reflexively defined through its own operation. An example of this would be in one particular function, once two numbers are inputted into a function, the new value will be produced that is always the sum of the previous two values. So the idea is as the function progresses, an automatic proliferation ensues that guarantees this expansion and propagation. But one of the most extreme cases of proliferation in this respect is the Ackermann function, which shows the astonishing increase of values given evaluation of very small inputted values into the function. So when these initial values are as low as 4 and 3, pretty low numbers, the result of the function is a number that is far more than the number of particles in the universe. It's something like a 19,000-digit number. And at the next step, the next two values, it produces, it outputs a number that cannot be notated in current mathematical notation. The point is that this function exemplifies a proliferation of such immense power that each step of its implementation produces values of which we can barely conceive and that quickly surpass any available mathematical notation to even represent such a value. Thus, once this function starts, it initiates a proliferation of itself so violent that its perpetuation is an unbounded proliferation, which effectively reduces this movement to a proliferation in itself. This is because the numerical values that are produced become as if the same, since they are so large that we can only really understand them in relation to or in terms of this very function. The product of proliferation is indistinguishable from the proliferation itself. In other words, All that is left is the hyperorder that conceals and immobilizes difference. Proliferation, in general, discloses spaces of which it can fill and envelop through an adjustable liminality. Spaces and limits that less bound the movement of proliferation than intensify the proliferation itself. Proliferation is always claustrophobic. When expansive, these prolific topologies ensure a containment in a perpetual growing abyss, falling through a bottomless pit, a black hole. When a contractive proliferation, the spaces that are created and filled become attuned to a centripetal force. When that transforms the power of proliferation into a compression, that is not so much reducing the space, but maintaining an unrelenting pressure, being trapped in quicksand or yielding to gravity. These are thus two examples of a prolific event in which the mechanisms of differential order undergo a malfunction that transforms the most fundamental ontological principles and disrupts its logic. Nevertheless, perhaps malfunction is somewhat hyperbolic. In the most simple terms, the differential is that which regulates and calibrates difference in becoming through a dynamic process of order and ordering. If this differential operation changes in such a way to intensify the static order and the crushing unity of the event, then an organization of difference and becoming can arise that effectively provides their own cancellation in the shadow of proliferation. Thank you.